Hello, everyone, and welcome to our presentation on backcountry paddling adventures with the kids. My name is Sarah, and I am one of the members of the Camping Across Ontario team. The other members, of course, are my husband, Corey, and our two daughters. Corey and I have been camping together for many years. We started out with simple car camping trips and eventually moved on to some short backpacking trips and then on to backcountry canoe trips. We moved south, got married, and had kids, took a few years off from the backcountry, but now we're back in the game and trying to do more every year. We both have full-time jobs with limited vacation time, but we both value our backcountry trips and we're making it happen. What we'll cover today? Why do we do this? We will dive briefly into trip planning, go through some safety measures, gear, food that we like to bring, and then go over a few more tips for tripping with kids. So why do we do this? Taking kids on a backcountry trip is a great way to introduce them to the natural environment and to help teach them to respect and care for nature. We have had a great time on our trip so far. We're so busy at home, just like everyone else. Time in the wilderness really does allow us to spend uninterrupted family time together. And truly, we can all benefit from taking a break from screens and technology. With kids, we've taken fairly basic trips so far with marked campsites and marked portages, but getting out in the backcountry really does provide a sense of adventure. Ontario has some beautiful places to explore, and by putting in a little bit of effort, we are able to get to places that many people will never experience. Also, the girls are rightfully very proud of all the tripping and portaging that they've done so far. It really does provide a sense of accomplishment. Trip planning, briefly. We could do an entire presentation just on trip planning, but basically, you're going to need to decide where you want to travel. We recommend starting out with provincial parks that have marked campsites and portages. Algonquin, Bonneco, and some other parks have paddle-in campsites where you don't have to worry about portaging at all. You need to consider the size of the lake. Are there portages? How long are they? How many are there? Are there rivers? Are there rapids? And will the water level be a concern? Your best bet is to talk to the Ontario Park staff if you're starting out with a provincial park. And then nowadays you can check on Facebook, on blogs, on YouTube, but the Canadian Canoe Routes website remains a great resource as well. If you are new to tripping with kids, my best advice is to take what you think you want to accomplish in a day and cut it way back, like in half to three quarters. Also, for us personally, this is our vacation time, and we don't want to stress about pushing our kids past their limits to go a certain long distance every day. We personally prefer to have lots of downtime to explore, play, and relax. Moving on to safety measures, you'll want to ensure that everyone on the trip is comfortable with the plan. My husband and myself, we both carry a copy of the map in a waterproof sleeve, and we both know where we are at all times throughout the trip. You'll want to tell a trusted person your route, including the day you leave, where you plan to stay every night, and the time that you plan to arrive back at the parking lot, or at least back within cell phone range. We also always carry an emergency signaling device with us, such as a spot or a Garmin inReach. Continuing with safety measures, you'll need to keep a clean campsite, including no food or toiletry items in the tent. And you'll need to hang or stash your food well away from your tent site. This is both to help deter bears and also to keep little critters out of your food. Those little ones can chew through your food supply really quickly and leave you on a miserable trip. You want to be mindful of the weather, and depending on the location, you may need to consider paddling early in the morning to avoid waves on larger lakes. And also, know your limits. How much can you reasonably paddle in a day? How much can you portage? How much are you able to physically carry across that portage? And depending on your fitness level, you may need to consider some physical preparation in advance of your trip. Moving on to talk about gear. A well-stocked first aid kit is an absolute must, and you may want to consider taking a first aid course or even a wilderness first aid course if that's available to you. As we previously mentioned, it's essential to have a map and compass and to know how to use them. You'll need to prepare to be well out of cell phone range. PFDs, or personal flotation devices, for us are non-negotiable for all of us at all times on the water. And speaking of water, you'll need a method of making water safe to drink, either by filtration or by water purification tablets. When Corey and I first started with backcountry tripping, we used one of these MSR pump filters, and that worked really well for us. It was sort of my chore. I'd go down to the water by myself and relax while pumping the water. But I must say, since having kids, we've changed to a gravity filter, and it's so convenient for us. Of course, you'll also need lots of sunscreen, a hat, and sunglasses. It gets really bright out there on the water. Moving on to the canoe, we, so far, our kids are small and we've been able to get away with one canoe for our trips. We've been renting an 18 and a half foot canoe. That gives us a third seat in the middle, and the girls have been sharing that third seat so far. We bring kid-sized paddles. Our kids love paddling, even if it's just for a minute or two. They love adding power to the boat, and it really helps them feel more involved in the trip. Our home away from home, our tent. We have a four-person Eureka El Capitan tent that we love. It has been great in the stormy weather, and we do set it up on the custom footprint to help protect the tent. We love our mech tarp as well, and setting up a tarp by the fire pit when it looks like it's going to rain really helps the site to feel like home and gives us a cozy, dry place to cook and to relax. We all have our own sleeping bags and sleeping pads. The kids have kid-sized sleeping bags. I feel this is important, especially on the cooler nights. A smaller sleeping bag means less airspace that the child will have to keep warm. It means your kid will stay warmer overnight. You may want to mentally prepare yourself that sleep may be limited the first night or two while everyone adjusts to the backcountry. I bring a small battery-powered white noise machine with us to help drown out unfamiliar noises and truly to help all of us fall asleep. When we're out in the backcountry, we do not rely on building a fire to cook. On well-used backcountry campsites and some island sites, deadwood for fires can be really hard to come by. We recommend bringing a stove and, of course, more fuel than you think you'll need. And we always use our stove for cooking. When we do make a fire, we involve the kids in the process by having them collect some sticks and small deadwood. For cookware, you can go as heavy or as light as you are willing to carry. We do bring both pots and a frying pan, and we bring plastic plates, bowls, mugs, and cutlery for all four of us. And we also carry a small folding sink and a rag to wash it all up with biodegradable soap. I love this picture that Emily took of Alyssa and I. I'm wearing almost all of my layers. You can see my jacket there, my toque, and Alyssa is in a t-shirt. I tend to run cold, and I just need to pack accordingly. Good quality rain gear, including both a jacket and splash pants, is essential for both the grown-ups and the kids. Toques are great for staying warm on cool, wet days and also for sleeping. I always pack a light but warm jacket. Being cold out there can make anyone miserable, and if you don't need to wear the jacket, it makes a great pillow. For the girls, I bring two full outfits, plus a t-shirt and shorts, and also a warm fleece sweater. I've been able to find lots of great items at thrift and consignment stores. I personally like to sleep in my long underwear. When we tripped in September, I brought fleece PJs for the girls and also an extra set of long underwear for me, just in case the daytime ones got damp. And of course, remember to bring lots of socks and underwear for the kids. For us on our trips, we choose to bring a proper pair of hiking shoes for both grown-ups and kids, and we wear those for portaging and exploring. And then we bring Keen sandals for relaxing around the campsite and sometimes for swimming. Also, depending on the time of year, I highly recommend kid-sized bug jackets. Ours are from the original Bug Shirt Company. For personal hygiene items, you know, the basics, toothbrush, toothpaste, biodegradable soap, deodorant, hairbrush, elastics. I store the toiletries in a separate dry bag within the food barrel. These all have a scent and they should never be kept in the tent. For toilet paper, bring more than you think you might need. I keep one of the rolls in a Ziploc bag with bug spray and hand sanitizer in my day pack, ready to go. And then you'll need a repair kit, which can include things like duct tape, a Thermarest patch, if you're bringing Thermarests, and a sewing kit, lots of rope, a soap and or a hatchet, a knife or multi-tool, and we bring headlamps as well. We've also been bringing a solar-powered light that we hang from the top of the tent like a nightlight. We've been bringing this Luminade, and it packs down really nice and small and lightweight. And moving on to our luxury items, we love our chairs. We have two lightweight collapsible chairs that we bring, and then we bring two of the stadium style seats that sort of clip into each other so they have a back support. Our hammock, Corey, I think, would say that this is not a luxury item. He would call it an essential item. Our kids love using the hammock like a swing, and then Corey will usually find some time to relax in there as well. You can bring a book if you like to read. I always have my cameras and my chargers. We do bring a small folding solar panel to recharge everything with. And then you can bring binoculars, really anything you like as long as you're willing to carry it. The nice. Girls are used to camping, and I do feel that a little bit of boredom is okay. It's wonderful to watch our girls play and explore in nature and to create their own games. However, I do have a tradition of packing some small toys and breaking them out when a surprise is needed. And again, thrift stores are great places to find these gems.
right, girls, let's portage. You got a stick, you're ready to go. Let's do this. Emily leading the way. Liz, you coming?
And then you're going to need packs to put everything in. What's been working for us, at least so far, we bring a 115-liter dry bag and then a Woods Mason canoe pack that's about the same size. For food and toiletries, we have a 60-liter food barrel. I bring a day pack, which is, I think, around a 30-liter backpack, and that has my items that I might need quickly, like my rain gear, bug spray, toilet paper, water bottle, camera, and my sandals. Emily has carried all her own gear, including sleeping bag, sleeping pad, pillow, clothes, water bottle, for years now in her own backpack, and Liz carries more every year. She's in the market for a larger backpack this year. The girls also carry their own PFDs and paddles across the portage. While I do think it is important to encourage your child to carry their gear across the portage, you need to know your child as well and how much you can push them while still making it somewhat of an enjoyable experience. And moving on to food. Many parks have a ban on cans and bottles, and really, you don't want to be carrying that much weight anyway. These days, you can buy a wide range of backcountry meals, or you can dehydrate your own food. And we will often try things at home to make sure that everyone likes it before dragging it out into the backcountry. The girls are great about helping with the food prep for our trips. In this picture here, they're helping me make the bannock mixture. Our breakfasts are almost always instant oatmeal. Some of us like to add some dried fruit. Bagels we'll keep for several days out there. On rest days, we might break out some bacon and some hash browns. A staple for the girls is peanut butter and jam on the soft flour tortillas. Those we'll keep for days out there as well. And of course, coffee. I myself just bring instant coffee, but there are backcountry presses and pour-over methods as well. And for everyone, hot chocolate is great on those cooler days. We dehydrate our own food. This is certainly not necessary, but for us, it allows us to bring simple meals that our kids are used to eating at home. In my opinion, the backcountry is full of new experiences, and then adding an unfamiliar meal is just a lot for anyone truly experiencing something for the first time. Some of our favorites are pasta, soft tacos or burritos, chili, rice and beans, and yes, of course, good old Kraft dinner. We also bring a lot of dried fruit to snack on. We all love bannock. Bannock is a fry bread traditionally made by Indigenous people and then voyageurs. There are many different recipes and techniques. We have been mixing the dry ingredients together at home, and then in the backcountry, we'll add water to make a dough and fry it up in some ghee. Ghee is clarified butter that doesn't need to be refrigerated. It's been so awesome to do this in the backcountry. We'll make it for dinner or for breakfast on a rest day. We have a rest day today on beautiful White Birch Lake. It is a beautiful morning, feeling like it's going to be a hot, hot day. But because it's a rest day, we're going to make a bannock for breakfast, and we have some... The audio is a little bit quiet on that video, but that's just showing it was Emily's day to help make the bannock on our rest day. And it's one of the backcountry chores that the kids really do enjoy. The key to a happy camper is often snacks. Take double what you think you might need. Also, for us on travel days, we don't stop to break out the stove to cook lunch. We will snack on dried fruit, Baby Bell cheeses, beef jerky, granola bars, that type of thing. Also, chocolate is a great motivator before or after a long portage.
Now this is the problem with a 60 liter food barrel. We're trying to fuel the kids with some chocolate, but it's involving digging deep into the barrel. Oh yeah, it's gonna be the fastest portage ever.
So we think we've solved this problem. Or at least we're helping with this digging through the food barrel problem. We did just purchase a couple of barrel organizers made by the Recreational Barrel Works Company, and we were able to find those from the organic boat shop recently at the Toronto Outdoor Adventure Show. So we're excited to put those to use this year. And now on to the good stuff. Keep it fun! Kids are only little for such a short time. Let kids be kids and join in the fun yourself. Backcountry trips are exciting on their own, but we will often add something extra for all of us to look forward to on our adventures. One year, we took the water taxi across Lake Opiongo in Algonquin that helped us to get deeper into the park, and the boat ride was super fun. The top picture here, we had planned a day trip to the Tim River for a picnic. And the other picture here, again in Algonquin, we hiked to an old growth forest. We build rest days into all of our trips and leave lots of time for relaxing, exploring, and swimming, which is my favorite and the girls' favorite for sure. More on the topic of keeping it fun. It can be difficult to maintain a positive attitude when things don't go according to plan, or if you're cold and wet and itchy. Mindfulness is a wonderful tool for everyone on the trip. You'll want to acknowledge your senses. What can you hear? What can you see? What can you smell or touch? Journaling is a wonderful activity too. For myself and for the girls, I always bring small booklets and pens. And whether we're just scribbling or drawing or writing something down, it's such a great activity. If you've got a long trail to tackle, give your kids the camera or your phone. It's so much fun for them. I feel like it helps them to acknowledge their surroundings. And also, it's so great to watch the videos that they create later on when you get home. If it's appropriate, give your kids some control. Let them decide what's for snack or what's for dinner, or even let them pick the campsite that night. Try to embrace the journey. Despite my best efforts, it always takes me a few days to relax and to get into the rhythm of the backcountry. It really does help just to pause and take a moment to look around and just admire the beautiful view. And of course, laughter is a great stress reliever and can lighten the mood when things get tough. Managing expectations is important, especially with kids. Talk to your kids well in advance of the trip about what might happen on a canoe trip. Get out the tent. Sleep in it at home if you haven't done that yet. Get out the packs. Portage around your yard or around the block. Just anything to help them feel a little bit more familiar with what's about to happen. It's okay to acknowledge fear and anxiety. We all experience it. But teach the kids about the safety measures and plans that you have in place. And finally, try to keep some perspective. This is supposed to be fun. Even if you are cold and wet and itchy, it's all temporary, and you'll leave with some great family memories. If you have any questions for us or comments about your experiences tripping with kids, please do share them in the comments below. This is such a great community of paddlers and campers, and everyone shares, and it's so wonderful to hear about other experiences. Thanks so much for listening to our presentation. Again, comment below if you have any questions or comments, and you can also follow us on Facebook or Instagram or Twitter. Happy camping!